G'day, I'm Dr. Karl, and I'm going back to school with my new best friends forever, Student Edge. You should too, they rock.
Well, Dr. Karl, tell me, what were you like as a teenager?
Well, basically at school, I was fairly solitary, often bullied because I was a wog kid with a funny name, having grown up as a refugee. At university, I tried to have sex and failed a lot. Well, I was basically a bit of a loner, which I didn't really want to be, but being a wog refugee, you didn't get a lot of slack in those days.
Was that tough? I mean, obviously, I assume it was tough, but did it galvanise you in a way to kind of throw yourself into your studies?
Not particularly. I was good at school because the Christian Brothers just bullied us and would hit us a lot. And then when I went to university, I didn't do any study because I didn't have to, and then did really badly the first time around.
So you weren't necessarily passionate about study or about science from early on?
No, I just drew. Well, I was very impressed by an astronomy book I got when I was seven. And what it said was that, hey, the solar system is big, the universe is just full of about 600,000 million galaxies, each with about 600,000 million stars. Oh my God, I could not believe the size of it. And that filled me with a sense of awe and wonder that we would never ever get to the end of knowing everything. And that sense of awe and wonder has always stayed with me. However, once I got to university and having to do some work, and without people bashing me up and hitting me if I didn't do it, I just simply did none and did really badly.
So were you curious as a child?
I always wanted to know what was going on. I always wanted to understand. But then it's come upon me more in later life. So once I went to New Guinea and then worked in research doing hair and wool and then become a drug-crazed hippie, and then I really wanted to understand exactly what is going on. I end up in New Guinea when I was 21, and I had a Land Rover, and I couldn't fix it. And suddenly I could see the disconnect, that I knew how the universe began with the Big Bang, but I couldn't fix the handbrake on the Land Rover. So there was something wrong with me. I wasn't fully balanced. So I ended up going into being a car mechanic, and that was a terrific education.
Do you still feel that same passion to know everything? Because even now, you know, if someone is esteemed as you and as learned as you.
Well, I am learned. I've got 28 years of education, thanks to the taxpayers of Australia paying for it. And I paid nothing. Thank you very much, taxpayers. Thanks. Thanks a lot. Thanks, guys.
There is a limit to how much a human can possibly take in a lifetime. Do you feel content now with what you've got under your belt?
I'm very happy to be on something that I recognise as an ultimately futile, asymptotic event to try and learn everything there is to know in the universe. And I know I'll never get there, and I'm perfectly happy with the path. I want to learn everything, I know I won't get there, but the journey is terrific.
Do you feel, as someone who has studied for close to three decades and beyond really, that we treat education as a means to an end?
Yes, and that's good and it's bad. So on one hand, you have to have stuff just stored in your skull. You've got to have a mental toolbox with little data bits in it. But then you need the imagination. And sure, anybody can pretty well do anything, but to do it brilliantly and to love it, then you need it to be sort of hooked in with your natural wiring up. So some people want to play a cello, and other people want to play a saxophone, and they just never want to cross. You've got to have the raw data in your brain, and you've got to go down what is at that time in your life, your natural pathway.
So while you were studying all that time, did you have particular career aspirations, something you were hoping to build towards, or were you just absorbing what you could take?
No to both. I was just floating like a paddle pop stick in the gutter of life on a rainy day, and discovered this sense of curiosity where I didn't have to do anything except float. And I found that I just loved knowing and learning and just absorbing stuff where I didn't have to do stuff. I was desperately poor. And so basically I lived off taxi driving, doing the minimum amount I could. And I'd live on brown rice and soybeans, which I bought in 20 kilogram bags. And the way I got my vegetables was that every Monday morning the greengrocers would throw out the stuff, so I'd go up with a wheelbarrow to the local greengrocer and just take bags and bags of stuff that he was throwing out. And the stuff that was bad, we chucked in the compost, and the good stuff, we ate. And so I lived well. without much money. Then the job was getting boring, so then I went into a different thing and I started studying biomedical engineering. And then Fred Hollows gave me a scholarship to design and build a machine to pick up electrical signals off the human retina. Because this time round, my second time round, I really wanted to study. I was doing it not just because it was a pathway, because of what I wanted to do.
Why is that? Why did you now want to do it?
I don't know.
just through the collection of your experiences, you felt like you finally got to a place where it was exactly what you needed and wanted?
I've been in a bunch of jobs, and I'd been very observant and seen that there are many people in jobs that they were doing that they didn't like, and it made them sour and unhappy, and I didn't want to be one of those people.
So then what is your advice to the curious out there who maybe don't have a particular career goal in mind where they can get into a particular field and just study and then go out into the workplace?
The amount of time that at this stage, by the time you get to the end of high school, that one has spent in the system between baby jail and high school is about 13 years, which is roughly the amount of time you get for murder in jail. So for some people, they're happy to go on and study. For other people, they need a year off. Both my kids took a year off. So with my daughter, we took her to Spain. We walked across Spain on the Camino, 790 kilometres in 5 weeks. And then we snuck off and dumped her. And she went to the University for Strangers or Foreigners in Perugia and learned Italian. My son also, he took a year off, went around the world and came back with a worm that big in his skull. You can see the advantages immediately of going around into the Amazon. So for some people you need a break, some people don't. Secondly, I think the education system in Australia does the high school students badly. It gives them in most cases it prepares them for university, and I think that's wrong. I like the Finnish system where you don't do any homework at all. Scandinavia, zero homework. And you work hard and you work solidly, and there's only government schools, no private schools. And the teachers all have a master's degree in education and a master's degree in whatever they're teaching. And they get paid $250,000 a year. And then you've got good teachers. And then you go through, everybody does the same course till about year nine or so, and then you split into the trades or university, depending which way your natural bent is, and we respect the trades. We don't do that in Australia. But in the Scandinavian and European countries, they do respect the tradies. But basically, you're living in the most peaceful time ever, you're smarter, and you can fix the problems. And you live long with CRISPR.
That is good news. Dr. Karl, thank you so much for talking to us today.
Thank you very much, Dr. Simon. Thank you.
Thank you. Hey guys, if you enjoyed that video, click here to subscribe to our YouTube channel or find more of our stuff at studentedge.com.au.